Hello and welcome to One on One. My name is Eugene Anangwe. Right about now, we want to have a look at some of the issues concerning our correctional facilities. And my guest in studio, as earlier announced, is none other than Mary Gahonzire, the Deputy Commissioner of the Rwanda Correctional Service. Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Jim.
Yes. So very quickly, just to get into the mood of the show, we want to be looking at some of the achievements, the developments, and of course, what's happening in our correctional facilities today. So let's look at the situation today as we speak, since the time that you got to this particular position. What kind of achievements can you tell me today that you've managed to make?
Thank you very much. Hello, listeners. Mm. We have achieved quite a lot with the support of government and generally Rwanda population and other stakeholders. Maybe we shall first have a look at the state mm-hmm. of the Rwanda correctional facilities
yes.
as of today. Mm. That rates from construction buildings, prison occupancy rate, social programs, welfare programs, health situation, mm-hmm. and all that. Mm-hmm. What I can say is we have 13 prisons mm-hmm. and one children rehabilitation center mm-hmm. in the eastern part of the country. Mm-hmm. We had two fire incidents
yes.
In this year,
yeah.
One in Muhanga, another one in Rubavu. Mm-hmm. This impacted on the prison occupancy rate. Mm-hmm.
When you say prison occupancy rate, for that listener of mine who probably doesn't understand what
right,
you mean,
yes.
how could you break that down in a simpler term?
It concerns congestion. Mm-hmm. It concerns the space each occupant occupies
in a prison.
This is in line with the international standards set.
Yes.
Before the fire incident, mm-hmm. we were at 104%, but this has gone down to 117%, mm-hmm. Meaning 104% mm-hmm. was way above what is required of the international standards. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, even at 117%, mm-hmm. we meet the international standards. Mm-hmm. But as a Rwanda correctional facility, we are determined to make these facilities a lot better. Mm-hmm. And we have achieved it. We have the budget. Mm-hmm. Of course, this fire incident was not budgeted. I mean,
it was not planned nothing. For.
It yes. was not planned for. Mm. But nevertheless, by the end of this year, we shall be way above. Yeah.
Okay. Let's talk about the fires, because you mentioned that. Today, as we speak, there are those who still say, why did we have to wait to do the renovations, to do the corrections in terms of wiring? Why did we have to wait all this time for us to be able to act? What really happened?
Regarding the fires,
yes.
Of course, this was an incident, a fire incident. It's a disaster. Mm-hmm. But of course, anything fire, you don't take it, you take it serious. Mm-hmm. This was given to the police for mm-hmm. investigations mm-hmm. and the report is not yet out. But hopefully, mm-hmm. we shall announce to you once we get it. Mm-hmm. But what I'm trying to say is, like in a disaster. Mm-hmm. There is the national disaster team. Mm-hmm. This was incorporated in the national disaster strategy mm-hmm. and measures have been taken mm-hmm. in regard to prevention mm-hmm. And general response. Mm-hmm. So quite a number of things we have done. So
after like this fire. Because yes. because you said in earlier on interviews with Contact FM, you had said that now you have trained prisoners in terms of yes. creating awareness on dealing
right,
with
yes.
fires. You have bought fire extinguishers. You have corrected the wiring system.
Yes.
Madam, why did you have to wait for the incident to happen for us to do this?
Well, it's unfortunate. Mm-hmm. This was like Yeah, it was Tasana Wares. We had measures in place, but for a fact, really, I think they were not adequate enough.
Okay.
So what we saw.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm saying is the national disaster team has really reviewed all this, and we are prepared.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is it true that we have some prisoners with cigarettes and lighters in prison?
No.
This is for a fact.
This is for a fact, and every 3 months we usually do a general search.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So you look for these kind of things and objects. But you said investigations are going on. So why do we rule out this?
Let's wait for investigation report, I think.
Okay.
It's better.
Okay.
You know.
Fair enough.
Mm.
Now, looking forward in terms of what activities happen at our correctional facilities, someone wonders, okay, what do they do there? Maybe if you can enlighten us a bit more.
There is quite a lot. Mm-hmm. It's a package. It's a correctional regime, as we call it in the terminology of corrections.
Mm-hmm.
There is quite a diverse, you know, program of corrections.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, for those ones who have been in schools,
yes,
for minors,
yes,
or even adults,
mm-hmm,
we are in partnership with Ministry of Education so that whoever comes continues with his or her formal education.
Mm-hmm.
There are these, we call it ubumenyingiro, mm-hmm, in Kinyarwanda.
Yes.
Quite a number of
activities.
Yes, activities. So they learn.
So those who are
there is
of
construction.
School, yes, those who want to continue schooling, they're able to graduate. They're able to do all that.
Yes, we have started that. There is the curriculum we designed for different people,
mm-hmm,
in partnership with REB.
Mm-hmm.
So we have started.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
But how do you look at the resource part? Do you have enough teachers? Do you have enough trainers? How can you explain that part?
We do have enough teachers or trainers.
Mm-hmm.
The first ones are the prisoners themselves, because they are those who have been teachers.
Okay.
So we vet them together, mm-hmm, with Ministry of Education.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have partnered with Ministry of Education, and we shall be getting teachers from outside.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We'll be coming back at, on some of these issues that we've already highlighted, but let's just look at the issue of the so-called prison breaks that many people have been talking about lately. We have numbers that were announced, and I don't want to mention them here, but I would like you to be the one to tell us what really happened, what are those figures, what do they represent, and what do they even mean?
Prison breaks were last announced last year,
mm-hmm,
and those were three prisoners.
Mm-hmm.
The issue was there is one part of the prison that was undergoing renovation.
Mm-hmm.
So there was that beat, that vent.
Mm.
So it was that weakness that they used.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, laxity on the side of our people.
Mm-hmm.
They went, but fortunately,
mm-hmm,
we worked with partners, members of the community. I must thank them now.
Mm-hmm.
The police,
mm-hmm,
and other security organs,
yes,
and we got them back.
So you're saying we only talking of three prisoners, but there were numbers that were gauging between 2014 and some time back, a few years ago. So
yes,
we had a staggering number of prison breakouts.
That stretched from 2008, if,
mm-hmm,
I remember.
Mm-hmm.
Then what made it go up,
mm-hmm,
where the community service people who are doing the community service,
mm-hmm,
otherwise TIJ.
Mm-hmm.
So Rwanda Correctional Service consists of,
yes,
people who are serving full-time in prison. Then there is a team that is in community service.
Yes.
And those were the people who were in that range of 2005
to 2014.
Yes.
That's that period.
Yes. And that stretched from 2007 to date.
But we're looking at 2091.
So,
prison if we, escapes.
What
between
I was,
that period.
Yes. Tij camps are camps. They are not prisons. So, we are, do you want to look at both, or you want to restrict yourself to the prison walls, inside the prison walls?
Let's talk about both of them, but let's start first of all with the camp first.
The Tij camps.
Yes, yes.
The Tij camps, these are people who are sentenced to community service. Mm-hmm. And these are the people who were handed over to by Gachacha.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these people are given to us. We receive.
Okay.
They come from the community and we receive them.
So these are the ones who escaped between 2005 to 2014.
We gave you the numbers of the people who had not done Tij. And we gave you the numbers of the people who had escaped. Escaped in a sense that within the law, there is where you give them. There is what we call Tij de proximité. The fellow works at the camp, at the site, and then he sleeps at his place within the proximity, within the local, his local area.
So are you trying to say that this prison breaks or escapes are being misreported?
But they are not. I think
that's why I'm asking
first,
that question. Are they are they being misreported?
There is misreporting, and then there is failure to get the context.
Okay.
What I can say is maybe you come and have a look at the Tij camps. Practically, they are run by our people. Yes, and they are members of the community also, and the local government, because these are people we work with them, and then they go back home. Between the time he leaves the camp, that is for Tij de proximité. You have practically no control over him. So it's a bit tricky. But what I can say confidently now is that we start with local authorities, the neighborhoods, and ourselves, and other security agencies that do support us, like the police.
Because there was
and
fear.
And we have streamlined.
Yes, yes. There was fear that if you have such kind of people serving a particular punishment and then they escape, because we're going to come into the wall breakouts now, and they escape.
Now talking about the community service.
Yes, yes. We're going to jump onto the wall breakouts just now. And this is why I'm saying this, because there are those who will say, okay, now, do I need to live with fear? If someone who was sentenced and locked up in a certain prison and they managed to jump out,
we are not talking about the breakouts.
Let's
now
jump into the wall breakouts.
Yes.
So you have people in the society who are now living with fear.
Yes.
Because there are people who jumped out of the prison. And have we got them back?
First of all, let's begin with fear.
Yes.
There is no fear in the Rwandese community regarding the prison breakups. We are talking about the walls now.
Okay.
The last wall breakup was in Ihuye, where we had three people going. And those were brought back.
Okay.
Why were they brought back? They were brought back because they committed the crime against humanity, the genocide. This is something that all Rwandese resent to death. They were actually got by the members of the community themselves. That was last year. Three people. One of them was called, I don't remember the names offhand now. The other one is a man that escaped with the assistance of one of our staff. That one of our staff was handed over to court for prosecution. Now, that person, when he got to Rurindo, his village, his own relatives are the ones who got
brought
him.
Them back.
No, him, one person.
Okay.
One person this year. So I think it should be clear understood mm-hmm. that there is no prison breakups in this country.
So no prison break?
No. Confidently, no. And there is no fear of perpetrators in our community.
Okay.
And there are those three incidents, and then there is one incident that was in Gasabo. So that was abetted by our staff, who was punished and expelled, by the way. So there is then Tij, the element of Tij, the proximity, and the fact that we did not have firm control over them right from 2007. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying, 2013, 2014, we've got a firm grip. Why do we have a firm grip on them now?
Tell me.
Because mm-hmm. we have trained personnel, many this time. We have given them skills mm-hmm. with the support of the police and other stakeholders. And we are in control. The other issue is the local authorities are very much with
supportive
us.
With
yes.
you. Yes.
Supportive.
I still feel it will be unfair not to fully clear the air on this report that came out. I will read it to you, and then probably you can now
put it out there
For the people. There was this report that said between 2005 and 2014, 2,091 genocide prisoners have managed to escape from prison. 95 of them managed to do so between January and June this year.
May I know the source, please?
This is one of, as I told you earlier on, we have a lot of reports going out there, people posting and saying these kind of things. When you hear these numbers, 2005 to 2014 and 2091 genocide prisoners, do those figures ring a bell anywhere? Do they mean anything? Are they real? Is there anything that happened that looks like that?
Where it rings a bell is on Tij.
Okay.
But those are the years from 2005 mm-hmm. and probably 2010, okay. 11. Mm. But what I can vehemently oppose mm-hmm. is that there are no prison breakups in Rwanda. Mm-hmm. Even before 2005 to date, mm-hmm. there were no prison breakups, but rather they were people who were supposed to come and serve the community service Tij mm-hmm. who did not come up
in
their
come.
Respective communities as had been prescribed by Gachacha. So please, let's get
that clear.
The facts clear. Mm-hmm. So they were no prison breakups in this country, and there is not going to be.
Okay. I love the confidence because at the end of the day, this is what is needed. Because when justice is served, the people who have been served the justice need to feel comfortable.
Yes. Then one other issue is because we closely work with the police, mm-hmm. there is no fear. Mm-hmm. So that record should be put correct. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
But talking of those Tij, those who are serving under the Tij
community
service, and this kind of not coming back as required or something like that, is that acceptable? Did they ever come back? Did we follow up? Are they back? What happened?
First of all, it is not acceptable. But what happened in 2005 onwards mm-hmm. was that, first of all, there were a few members of staff mm-hmm. that were following them up.
Yes.
Even those few members of staff were not trained mm-hmm. because they were just a civilian community. Mm-hmm. They were from Tij, the executive secretariat of Tij. So in 2011 mm-hmm. is when we put together the prison, the national prison.
So as we speak today, we don't have facts that they were finally brought or arrested or rearrested. Do we know anything like that? Do we have any idea, or they're still out there?
They were brought back by the local communities. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, mm-hmm. in 2005, mm-hmm. People were... We had the civilian community from Tij Secretariat, if you do understand the system.
Yes, yes. Mm.
If you were here that mm-hmm, time.
Mm-hmm. I wasn't, yeah. But,
you weren't,
but I understand, yes.
But I encourage you to get in touch with people who who know the difference between prisons mm-hmm. that time in 2005 mm-hmm. and TIJ mm-hmm. and the creation of TIJ and the subsequent creation of the Rwanda Correctional Service. Mm-hmm. That was a merger mm-hmm. of the prisons then that were under Minister of Internal Affairs mm-hmm. and then the Secretariat of TIJ. Mm-hmm. TIJ is just a community service sentence, mm-hmm. which was monitored by members
of the community, right?
Yes.
Now let's jump.
But
into
we have put it straight now.
It's now straight. Mm. Probably, if there's any contention, it might come later.
Yes.
But let's talk about now the state of affairs inside our prisons and what more can be done in terms of what some quarters or some people will say, making it comfortable for even prisoners to be in prison. I'll give you comparisons of some of the activities or things that have been happening in other countries. We saw some time back in a country like Kenya, just our neighbor here, mm-hmm. where prisoners were even given TV sets to watch TV and their life was so comfortable and all that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. How comfortable or how far can your institution go in making those who are in prison comfortable? Okay. When you say comfortable.
Okay. We were given a budget of 11,800,000,000. Mm-hmm. That is for construction and renovation, including other facilities mm-hmm. like television, radios, blankets, and other items. Mm-hmm. And improving the prison occupancy rate that we are talking about. Mm-hmm. This at the same time includes the medical insurance. And on record again that we are the only country that provides prisoners with medical insurance.
What of that person who will be out there and says, why do they deserve that? They have done this wrong, and so why do they have these privileges?
We consider it a basic requirement mm-hmm. In our country.
Okay.
Every person must have good health, so including prisoners. Mm-hmm. So other than these ones that are prescribed by the law, mm-hmm. everybody is supposed mm-hmm. and it's his entitlement to get treated and good.
Okay.
Good health. Mm-hmm. The other one is education, of course. Mm-hmm. We are having schools, classrooms, as per the recipient's wish. So it's an ongoing educational program, mm-hmm. as we're talking about.
Okay.
So it's comfortable.
It's comfortable.
Yes.
Okay.
Comfortable in courts. Mm-hmm. Remember, this is a detention facility, but a detention facility that has all the requirements internationally.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Let's talk about those who have said that our correctional facilities are closed to the public. The public is not able to see, when I say public, through the eyes of the media. We have had situations where there are quarters, a cross-section of people who say, no, it is not possible. You want to come and cover those activities inside the prison, probably the worship going on in prison for those who do worship, probably the games inside the prison, whatever activities you do. Could you tell us why is this the case, or is it true? Could you confirm or deny that it is not possible to have the picture of what happens in our prisons through the eyes of the media?
We have an open door policy. Mm-hmm. To our correctional facilities, mm-hmm. TIJ or even prisons.
Yes.
But one requirement is that you've got to write to the Commissioner General. And what we do is just for record purpose. And we just open. There's quite a number. You go to whichever, our farms, mm-hmm. inside the prison. There are these pictures you saw the other time when prisoners were graduating, mm-hmm. those who were undertaking Bible study, it was mm-hmm. there. Mm-hmm. So it's so open.
But it say that those pictures are taken from inside and then sent to...
From
so
inside.
It's possible today I can come in the prisons and say I want to cover the activities that happen there. Okay.
There is even a video to it actually when they were graduating, those ones in Nyanza.
Okay.
The public relations officer can give it to you.
Okay.
So thank you so much for all those remarks. Asante sana, Madam Gahonzire, for all the clarification. For those who had been talking about prison break, definitely, we will definitely be looking at the opportunities in the next session, which will be in Kenya, Rwanda. That is at 7:30. But thank you so much for being with us on the show. Thank you. And in fact, I admire your pronunciation and articulation in English.
Thank you so much.
I had to tell you this. Thank you so much.
I request that you put the record straight from 2005 to 2014.
You have actually done it yourself. They've had it. They've had it from
you. Yes. And by the way, our prisons are the best in the region, if not on the continent.
Mm-hmm.
Because as I'm telling you, that 117% is way above the international standards.
Mm-hmm.
And we are in the lead.
Mm-hmm.
And again,
now that you say we can be able to come into this
and
prisons,
that is why, of course, we are the chair to the group of friends of the UN Corrections.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much for those clarifications. And hopefully we'll be able to tell this story in pictures from inside these prisons. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks for your support.
Thank you. This is One-on-One. Definitely hope to see you again next time, same place. My name is Eugene Anangwe. Goodbye for now.